And let us be focused on you this morning, Lord. Amen.
Amen. All right, kiddos. Head on out of here. Yeah, that was good. That was good. The great I am, the great I am. Yes, I am. Don't mess with me. I always love rainy Sundays, all right? My last name is Rainwater, so that gives it away right there. But I always say I love rainy Sundays because you get to see who you're going to be in heaven with. Yes, I'm going to get in trouble today, and I'm looking forward to it. I'm just feisty today, so watch out. Hey, we're going to be in John 10, but don't go there just yet, all right? Because I need to ask you a question. I need us to think about this, and I need to really be serious about this. Can we trust the gospel accounts that they are accurate? Can we trust them that they are an accurate representation? Okay? Now, I know you good church folks, you're nodding like crazy. All right, yes, yes, mm-hmm, yeah. How do you know? Because it's in the Bible, all right? Because that's what somebody tells. Well, that's not a good enough answer for 90% of the people outside of this room. You with me? All right, I'm fine if that's how you want to roll it. But I need you to understand that's not a good enough answer for everybody out there. All right, and that's not a good enough answer for people looking and searching and trying to find truth, and trying to find something that they can hold on to. All right, especially for these young bucks over here. You know what? Their culture tells them don't trust the Bible, don't trust the church, and they're going, well, what are we supposed to hold on to? And the best answer you've got is, well, you're just supposed to. That's not good enough. We need to know why. We need to know we can trust the gospel accounts. We can trust what's written in the Bible, because then we will use what is written in the Bible to bolster up our faith, to create that faith, and to activate our faith. So I want you to look at Luke 1 before we get going today. Luke 1. Now let me give you a little background on Luke before you go in. Some of you, you know, he was a doctor. All right, and you're going, wow, must have lived in the country club, all that good stuff. No. Doctors in the first century were generally stationed on ships, and they would be the person almost like, more like an EMT type lifestyle than the country club doctor type lifestyle. All right, you with me on this? All right, he was a slave, okay? He was not someone who had his own practice, all this stuff. He was a slave that the ship owner would hire to be on the ship with him in case anything went wrong, okay? So if you think you've got this elevated, ooh, he's a big high up kind of a guy, that's not Luke, okay? And Luke was writing to a guy named Theophilus, as we'll look at this. So everybody look at Luke 1. And the question is, can we trust the gospel accounts that they are accurate representations? So Luke, a Greek man, all right? He's not a Jew. He did not grow up anywhere near Jerusalem, all right? We don't even catch up with him until he's already, Paul's halfway across Turkey, all right? So Luke writes this. He says, many have undertaken to compile a narrative about the events that have been fulfilled among us, just as the original eyewitnesses and servants of the word handed them down to us. Again, who were the eyewitnesses? Who were the servants? These are the disciples. These are the apostles. These are guys that Luke has been interacting with probably for the last 10 years or so. He's meeting Peter. He's meeting John. He's meeting James, the brother of Jesus. I think he and Mary hung out for a long time. I think he just picked Mary's brain and said, tell me everything, all right? Because the accounts of the narrative of Jesus' birth are just too accurate, right? There's too much information there for him to go, well, Mary told somebody who told somebody who told somebody who had a cousin who knew something about this. I think he sat down with Mary. Verse 3 says this, it also seemed good to me since I have carefully investigated everything from the very first to write to you in an orderly sequence, most honorable Theophilus. We kind of believe Theophilus was an actual man, all right? His name means the one who is loved or loves God, Theo. And Phyllis, all right, one who loves God, so that you may know the certainty of the things about which you have been instructed or taught. So Luke is writing this, and he says, I carefully investigated. I went to eyewitnesses. I went over all the facts. I went over all the information. I even went to the guy's mom, probably, all right, and got the stories. And I'm writing you, Theophilus, so that you'll have an accurate understanding of this, okay? So what if somebody gives an eyewitness account, and somebody else is there as well and goes, that's not what happened? What happens to your story at that point? We see this in politics all the time, right? Somebody makes up something, then somebody goes, that's not what happened at all, all right? And the press just keeps running with it over and over, all right? But that's a whole other issue, all right? Luke is presenting this, and he's saying, I've carefully investigated this. You can know, you can believe in this. Peter says almost exact same thing in his letter in 2 Peter 1. Peter, the disciple of Jesus, says, I was there. Luke had eyewitnesses. I was one of those eyewitnesses. I saw with my own eyes what happened. John writes in his gospel, he says, I'm writing all of these things down, all of these events, I'm writing them so that you might believe that Jesus was the Christ, the Messiah, the Son of the living God. And in so doing, then you might have eternal life. So the accuracy of what's written in the text and the accounts of all the miracles and the works of Jesus, these are crucial. We understand and have faith in them and we trust them. Which if you're against Christianity, what's the argument? What do you want to do with all the accounts of the miracles and all these things of Christ if you want to undercut the gospel message? If you're Satan himself who has one desire only is to steal you away from God your Father, what do you do with all the accounts of Jesus? You undercut him. Well, that didn't really happen. Well, that, you know, there's no way that happened. Basically, you become the director of the History Channel, all right? You with me? Just don't. Don't watch anything about Jesus on the History Channel. National Geographic, none of them, all right? I'm a little sketchy on the Hillsong channels, but that's just me too, all right? Don't, because what do they want? They want to undercut. You have to place your faith and your trust in what was written here. Luke gives you an orderly account. So the question is, do you believe that orderly account? Do you listen to the stories and can you place your trust and your faith that that really happened? And if that really happened, I have to deal with whoever it was that was doing that. I can't ignore the person of Christ if that is real, if that is true, if these stories and these things are accurate. And see, that's the question today. Are you one who believes it and has responded to it? The question we're going to ask today is, are you out of the sheep? Jesus has his sheep, his flock. He calls them my own. And my question to you is, are you one of those? Because Jesus is going to place this on the table. And he says, I have my sheep, my own. And then there are those who are not my sheep. You have to answer that question today. Where are you? Are you in the fold of Christ or are you out of it? Because there is no middle ground. Don't listen to the lie. You are either in the fold of Christ or you are out of it. And the consequences are eternal. Answer the question today, who is Christ? Let's go to John 10. I know, Father, I'm getting there. All right? I love it. You know the Irish guy on Braveheart? I love it. The guy, he talks to God just all the time. That's my favorite part of that whole movie. So I'm going, Father. All right. So John 10, maybe verse 22. Let's set the context. John sets the context. He starts off with this in John 10, verse 22. It says, then the festival of dedication took place in Jerusalem, and it was winter. Okay? Now, festival of dedication, all right, 164 BC, okay? 160 years before Christ comes along. There was a guy, and essentially what would happen is you had the Egyptians and the Syrians. Okay, now I'm sorry, I've got to do this on the map, right? So the Syrians are up here, here's Israel, and here's Egypt down here, right? Okay, when Alexander the Great dies, they divide up his kingdom and it goes four parts, four different ways, okay? I'm going real nerdy with you today, okay? The Syrians and the Egyptians became the two powerful people. And for like 300 years, they just trounce through Israel and go try and kill the other guy. And then the other guy trounces through them and tries to kill the other guy. And all of a sudden, and Israel just is sort of the stomping ground for the Syrian and the Egyptian army. Well, one of the Syrian kings was named Antiochus the Fourth Epiphanes. Ash and I argue over how to pronounce it. Antiochus or Antiochus, we can go either way. The Fourth Epiphanes. Well, on his way through one time, he was so mad because he lost the battle, he thought, I'm going to go to that temple in Jerusalem, and I'm going to defile the temple, and I'm going to sacrifice a pig on the altar. I mean, that just was like, that's enough right there. In the end times, it says there will be a time there where there will be the abomination of desolation. I mean, something so vile will be placed in the temple that God will vacate the temple, all right? Well, Antiochus the Fourth Epiphanes does this in 164. Well, that didn't sit real well. So a guy named the Hammer comes along, all right? The Maccabean Revolution comes along, and they kick out the Assyrians and reestablish the temple. And they have to rededicate the temple, clean it all out, do all the work in there, and clean it out. And now they have this feast of dedication, okay? I know, I'm getting there, all right? So we get into this idea, this festival of dedication. Well, part of this was there had to be light. They had to have this light. Well, they only had enough oil for one night. But it didn't last just one night. How many nights did it last? 8 nights, which is we get our Hanukkah, all right? No Adam Sandler singing this morning, all right? Some of y'all wanted that, I know, all right? But this is the feast of dedication, to rededicate the temple. So Jesus is in the midst of this. Now, get a feel, because when you read the text of the Bible, don't just read words. It's not just black and white words on a page. It's a conversation, but it's also a story. And there's a story to this. So Jesus is walking through at this time. Now, what's the mood at the Feast of Dedication? It's Hanukkah. Come on now, all right? You're wearing your yarmulke, all right? You're doing all this stuff. I told them to get in trouble. All right, so they're having a good time, and Jesus is walking along. But look what happens. And it's winter, which is never any good for me, but I just don't like winter, all right? And Jesus is walking the temple complex in Solomon's colonnade. Verse 24 says, then the Jews surrounded him. Can you really surround Jesus? Just get the picture. So Jesus is just walking through the temple. He's in Solomon's colonnade. He's hanging out. Hey, how are you doing? Good to see you. Good to see you. And all of a sudden, he gets surrounded. He goes, oh, no, I'm surrounded. Does that happen with Jesus? Can't you see him going, well, good job. You finally made a circle, guys. All right, you can't surround Jesus. You can't sneak up on Jesus. Like I always say, never think around Jesus. He's going to know what you're thinking, right? All right, and you can't surround him either, okay? So the Jews surrounded him. So what's John implying in the text? When you surround someone, is that for their benefit and for their joy? No. This is literally the same word for besiege someone. So when you lay siege to a city, are you going, we just came to do some Christmas caroling? No. This is devious. I just want there to be a couple of guys that are just really curious, though. So the Jews surround him, and they ask this question. Look at this question. How long are you going to keep us in suspense? Literally saying, how long will you hold our souls up? Almost like, how long will you dangle our souls above us? That's a literal interpretation of it. How long are you going to keep us in suspense? If you are the Messiah, tell us plainly. Don't sugarcoat things. Don't tell us these crazy stories. You know, just tell us. Just answer the question. My kids hate it when they come to me with a homework question, right? Because what do I do? Do I tell you plainly? Do I go, oh, the answer is C. Move on, go away, leave me alone. No. I say, well, let's think through this. And I go back 400 years in history. I don't care if it's math class or what. I'm going back in history. And they're like, just tell me plainly. That's what these guys are doing. Just tell me if you are the Christ. Now, that begs the question, who's the Christ? What is this idea? What is this? What in their mind? Who is this person, this Messiah, this Christos? All right, same word, one's Hebrew, one's Greek. Don't get too weird about it, okay? So the Messiah, the Christos, same idea. Who is this guy? Now, most of them would say, well, he's son of David. He's going to come along, and he's going to be this king, this eternal reigning king, and he's going to make those guys go away, and he's going to make us kings again. If you think back to Solomon's reign, they used to say during Solomon's reign, if someone dropped silver on the ground, they wouldn't even bother to pick it up because it was as common as the stones. There was no war during Solomon's time. It was this amazing time where everything was peaceful. They were wealthy. All the nations bowed down to them. And you see, the people of the first century are looking for the guy that can make that happen again. And he's been promised. So they know he's coming. So they keep looking for the Messiah, the Christ, the one, the son of David, who's going to reign just like Solomon. And this is where they miss it. You see, because the Messiah did not come the first time to be like Solomon. Oh, he's coming back, and he will be like Solomon. But he came the first time to be like David's unnamed son. You see, when Bathsheba got pregnant, when David and Bathsheba had their little affair, and she got pregnant, there was a child who was born. And that innocent child died on the seventh day. You see, you don't get your name until the eighth day in Jewish tradition. So the innocent child died, and guess who lived? David. Do you see the exchange of the innocent for the guilty? Do you see the Messiah who came along? All right, now here's the trick. The Messiah, does he have to be the Son of God? Careful, just think on this. Does the Messiah, this coming reigning king, does he have to be the Son of God? Was David? The Messiah is supposed to be just like David, the son of David. He's going to take over and do David-type stuff. So does he have to be the Son of God? No. At no point does it say the Messiah, in the understanding of Solomon, the reigning king, it doesn't say he is the Son of God. And so that's who they're looking for. So when Jesus comes along and starts saying what? I and the Father are one. Well, who do you think you are? That's blasphemy. You see, what they don't understand is to be the atoning sacrifice, he could not be the son of David. Right? No more than I could be the atoning sacrifice. I have sin in my life. If I'm born into the line of Adam, I have Adam's sin on me. Jesus had to be the Son of God to be the sufficient atoning sacrifice for me and for you. Does he have to be that to be the Messiah? No. And their understanding of who the Messiah was did not line up. So every time Jesus implied or inferred that he was the Son of God, they lost their minds because they thought that was blasphemy. Because they never understood that Jesus came as the unnamed son. They were just looking for Solomon. That's a very dangerous place to be. Hebrews 9 even says this. He says, the Messiah came once to die and to pay for our sins, but he's coming back a second time to save us. We have the unnamed son who died in our place, exchanged our guilt for his, but he's coming back again the second time to save us from the wrath of God that he is going to pour out on an unbelieving world. That's how this game is going to be played. This is the structure of this. That's why it's so important that you understand who Christ is. That's why it's so important that you understand who Jesus was. So he says, how long are you going to keep us in suspense? If you're the Christ, tell us plainly, all right? And he says, he responds with this. Look at it in verse 25. I did tell you, and you don't believe. Jesus answered him, the works that I do in my Father's name testify about me, but you don't believe because you are not my sheep, or not out of my sheep is a better translation, all right? It's not, you're not my sheep. It's not, you're not out of my sheep. You're not one of me. You're not one of us. You didn't come out of these sheep, all right? You're not of this. So let's break this in a little bit. I did tell you and you don't believe. What's the first thing? One of the first things Jesus says, according to Luke's gospel, in Luke 4, he goes to Nazareth. He goes into the synagogue on the Sabbath day. He goes in there. They pull out Isaiah's scroll, and Jesus starts reading from Isaiah 61. And it says, you know, he will proclaim liberty to the captives. He will proclaim goodness to the poor. He will do all these things. And it's this messianic writing of Isaiah. And Jesus reads this about how this Messiah is coming, and he's going to do this, and he's going to do this, and he's going to do this. And he sits down, which is the teaching position, and he goes, I'm here. Today, this scripture has been fulfilled in your midst. And what do you think happens? What do you think happens when Jesus says, I'm here, I'm the Messiah, in this sort of cryptic way? They take him and try and throw him off the cliff. What happens every time Jesus claims any type of deity or divinity? They try to kill him right up to Good Friday. Every single time. Is he telling them? Yes. John the Baptist, he's about to die. He's in prison. What does he do? He sends his guys. He says, I need you to go ask Jesus a very simple question. Are you really the Christ? Or should we be looking for another? And Jesus replies with what? The deaf hear, the blind see, the lame walk. What do you think? These miracles are happening. This is who I am. He is telling them plainly, but they don't believe. Keep going with this. You don't believe because you are not out of my sheep. Now, what's the basis of his belief or his argument of, you should believe because this, the works. He says, the works I've done, these are the ones that testify to me. Now, I bet you have a favorite miracle or a favorite story or a favorite moment in the life of Jesus that you would give anything to have a video of. Amen? Would you? All right. My favorite is when the four guys lower the paralytic down. All right. When they bust through the roof, they drop this guy down. All right. And the guys, the big hat guys, the religious guys, are sitting on the chairs while everybody else is standing, all right, real gentleman there, all right? And he drops this guy right here in the middle, and Jesus looks at him and goes, your sins are forgiven. And all the big hat guys go, well, you can't do that. All right? And Jesus, of course, don't think around Jesus, right? So Jesus sits there and goes, oh, you think that's just too easy for me to just say that? Well, what if I were to tell this guy just to stand up and walk out of here? Would that convince you? And he looks at him and goes, do it. Let's go. The guy gets up, walks out. And now I just imagine him walking by for the first time, mind you, all right, walking by the big hat guys going, I got to go with him. This guy must know what he's doing. I'm walking. I was lowered down, but I'm walking out. What do you think? All right. What's your favorite miracle? Come on, yell them out. Yell them out. What's your favorite? What one do you want to have the video of? Go. Healing the child. Good. What? Walking on water. Come on. Lazarus. We'll get to that in 2 weeks. What? Ooh, gosh, this that healing stuff. That would just, can you imagine changing that life? Come on, come on, come on. Parting of the sea. Yep. What else? Yeah, because that's a lot of food coming out of just keep feeding. All right. Do you see the stories? This is why I asked you, can we trust the accounts? Because if we can trust the accounts, then we know we've got to deal with this person. He is not someone we can ignore as just that crazy talker. He's someone we must deal with. And that's what Jesus is saying. I did tell you and didn't believe. The works that I do testify to me, but you don't believe because you are not out of my sheep. You're not one of my sheep, because my sheep, they do what? Look at it. They hear my voice. My sheep hear my voice. I know them and they follow me. That idea of hear my voice, you know, in the first century, the shepherd would have a distinct call for his own sheep. They used to say it was not even really a coherent, hey, come over here now, kind of a thing. It's like whoop, 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 whoop. All right, whatever you do, it sounds like A&M football game. All right, you're doing something like that. And they would respond. They would be like, that's my shepherd. That's my shepherd. Imagine how God feels when he calls out to us and we respond with, that's my Savior. You know, I think sometimes we allow God to become far too distant. We allow God to be sort of that Savior guy, and that he's that big God guy in the sky, and the man upstairs, and we forget that he interacts Jesus is the one that tells the story of the lost sheep. What happens if you've got 99 and they're here, but you've got one lost? What do? You go find the one. Why? Because that's one. And that worship of that sheep and that relationship I have with that one sheep is worth anything to me. I say having twins taught me this. See, for most of you, those two just look alike and they're just sort of the same person. But I know them distinctly. They are not indispensable. I joke we had two in case I lose one, all right? But they're both indispensable as much as Holland is. See, for you, they look alike, but for me, they're indispensable. And that's how every single one of you in this room is to your Heavenly Father. And how does he feel when you hear his voice and you respond? He says, I know them. I know their name. He used to nickname all the sheep. I asked you last week, what's your nickname? What has God nicknamed you? See, to get a nickname, you have to have a relationship, right? And some stupid, horrible moment when you probably shouldn't have done that, all right? That's how you get most nicknames, right? What's your nickname? God knows you. You are that lost sheep that he goes after. But here's the contrast. If you're not of this sheep, you don't respond to the voice of God. You don't respond to the call of God, and he does not know you. In fact, one of the parables, it says, I looked at these and they didn't help the poor. They didn't help the hungry and the needy and those in prison and those in sick. And he says to him, depart from me. I never knew you. But he knows his own. And they follow me. I always like to ask the question, how did I get here? Was I following Jesus here, all right? On that website, watching that channel, having this conversation, did I follow Jesus into this conversation? And the answer is generally what? No, I ain't following him. He's over there going, what are you doing over there? I'm over here. Don't you hear my voice? Don't you hear me calling out to you? You see, what competes? What competes with the voice of the shepherd? He says to him this. He says, I've given them eternal life. Zoe Ion, right, Zoe? Zoe Ion, I told Zoe I'd pick on her this week. Zoe means life. It means exuberance. It will give you eternal life. Look at the rest of this. And they shall never perish or be destroyed. Remember, the thief comes to do what? To steal, kill, and destroy. And Jesus says, these are my sheep. No one's going to get my sheep. You aren't going to steal them. You definitely aren't going to kill them in a sacrificial way. That's what that word means. And they will never be destroyed, eternally, utterly destroyed, ever, ever, ever. And because of this, they will never, anyone will ever be able to snatch them out of my hand. They are mine. They are in my hand. And no thief and no wolf will be able to steal them away. Remember, there's a context. And in John 10, he talks about the thief and the robber. The thief will steal, kill, and destroy. And the wolves, when the hired man runs away, will snatch them away. Snatch them out of the hand, out of the pen. He says, No, I'm the good shepherd, and they are my sheep, and they hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. If this was a quiz, how well would you do? Do you know his voice? Does he know you? Do you follow him? Is I give them eternal life and they will never perish ever. No one will snatch them out of my hand. My Father who has given them to me is greater than all. No one is able to snatch them out of the Father's hand either. The Father and I are one. And what happens every time Jesus equates himself with the Father? They pick up stones to try to kill him. Why? Because what is their understanding of the Messiah? He's the son of David. And anyone who calls himself the son of God is a blasphemer. They're not the same things in their mind. And you got to get your head around that. And then you'll understand why there was so much conflict. So they pick up stones. Now, if someone was around you, surrounded you, and was picking up stones, how might you react? think about it. You're surrounded. You went all bold. You got all cocky. You went all bold. And the Father and I are one. Everybody starts picking up stones. What do you do in this moment? I love this. Run. Again, verse 31. Again, the Jews picked up rocks to stone him. And Jesus replied, I've shown you many good works, many kalos, kala, many beautiful works from the Father. For which of these are you stoning me? Which is a really good question, right? But not the question I would ask when someone's about to throw rocks at me to try and kill me, all right? My idea is to get away. Jesus says, hey, let's have a little talk. Why? You see, sometimes you got to get in the story. You can't just read the story from a distance and go, look at that over there. Look at what's going over there. Sometimes when you read the Bible, you have to get into the story. And you got to look around and you got to see people and you got to see personalities and you have to see the dynamics in play. Why is Jesus interacting with the people who are not out of his flock? And why does he jump in the middle of this and ask them a pointed question? Why does God do anything like that? How does he feel about the people who just picked up rocks? They're not of his flock, right? So what does he care? They've been predestined to hell. So what does he care? Maybe they haven't. Maybe God loves them, the ones picking up rocks, as much as he loves his 12 who are going, we got to get out of here now. And so instead of saying, you know what? You're going to go to hell and I don't care. He says, let's talk. Let's talk. Let me engage with you because I haven't predestined anyone to be in hell. You see, hell was created for the devil and his angels, not for you. Those are Jesus' words, not mine. Which of these works? Which of these works? For blasphemy, they said, because you're just a man and you're claiming to be God. Now, here's where it gets kind of interesting and kind of we lose a lot of people. He quotes Psalm 82 at this point, all right? Now, you can see the text from John 10. You can look at it here in verse 34. Jesus answered him, isn't it written in your scriptures, I said you are gods? If he called those whom the word of God came to gods and the scripture cannot be broken, do you say you are blaspheming to the one the Father set apart and sent into the world because I said, I am the Son of God, all right? Now, I've got this text of Psalm 82 and I'm already tight on time and it would take me about 45 minutes to explain what he's talking about right there, all right? And I wouldn't get too far other than to say this. What he's saying is, you know, I am putting myself out there as the Father and I are one. But skip down a couple of verses and you'll see his point to this whole thing. And if you want to talk Psalm 82, find me. Love to play that game, all right? I can play that game all day long. But look at what he says in verse 37. If I am not doing my Father's works, don't believe me. If I'm not doing it, don't believe me. Again, this is why we have to have some confidence in what the Word of God says and the actions of God and the actions of Christ. If I'm not doing what God sent me here to do, don't believe me. Imperative statement, right? Imperative statement to whom? Who's he talking to? Is he talking to the saved people? Or is he talking to the Pharisees? Who are those not out of my flock? He's giving them an imperative. Don't believe me if I'm not doing this. But, okay, keep going with it. Verse 38, but if I am doing them, which he was, and you don't believe me, believe the works. This way you will know and understand that the Father is in me and I in the Father. Don't believe me. Jesus looks at these Pharisees and he says, if I am doing the works, and you don't believe me, this person, all right? And why would you not believe? Why would you not believe him if he is doing these works? You know, believe it or not, some people don't like me. I know. Ashley can't believe it. Believe it or not, you know, I taught school for a while. So my students, they didn't like me at the time. They like me now, right? You like that teacher. But you know what? I think some people just didn't like Jesus. I don't think they, because maybe he parted his hair the wrong way. Maybe they just didn't like the way he walked. Maybe, I don't know. We're pretty bad about this, aren't we? We can think of all sorts of reasons not to like somebody we don't like, right? It's called confirmation bias. You always find what you're looking for. And I think there were people that just didn't like Jesus. And I think Jesus recognized that, and he says, look, if I'm doing the works and you don't believe me because you'd want to believe this, believe the works. Know that the Father is acting. Know that the Father is active and he loves you and he's going to do something in your life. Don't let personality take you away from the Father. Kids, do not let parents or anyone telling you your parents are wrong, misguided, whatever, because if Satan can turn you away from your parent, he will turn you away from your God. Believe me on this. Satan has no interest in trying to get you to turn away from God. He just needs to turn you away from your parents. You know why? Because your parents are the ones who are supposed to be discipling you into the Word of God. Maybe it's the person discipling you. Maybe it's Austin in the youth ministry. Maybe it's me. He doesn't have to turn you away from God. He has to turn you away from the one who's telling you about God and leading you into a relationship with God. So he says, believe the works. You see, I loved about Jesus, he wasn't caught up in him being the center of attention. It was the works of the Father. So he says, the Father is in me and I am in the Father. So what do they do? What happens every time? He says, the Father is in me and I am the Father. The Father and I are one. That's it, blasphemy, here we go again. All right, it's the same idea. And they try to seize him, but he eludes their grasp. Now at this point, he leaves the temple area. He goes across the Jordan where John was baptizing people. It's about a 10, 12 mile walk away. And he goes across the Jordan and it says, many came to him. Many came to him, many of whom? Many of his flock? Many of the ones who've been nodding, agreeing, believing all this time? Or was it maybe some of those that surrounded him that day who were not of his flock but said, I want to hear more? He intrigued them with the works. He put an idea out there. If I'm not doing the works, don't believe me. But if I am, you have to answer for who I am. You have to answer it if God's works are true. If what Christ was doing was miraculous, you have to answer the question, who is Christ? Who was this Jesus guy? Because your eternity hangs in the balance of your answer. And many came across the Jordan, and they sat and they listened. They said, John, he didn't do any miracles, but he told us about this guy. And this guy came and did exactly what John told us he would do. And he did all these works, and he did all these miracles, and he healed people. And the blind are seeing, and the lame are walking, and the deaf are hearing. And we just ate with 5,000 other guys from a sack lunch. What's your answer? You see, when Jesus says this, he hasn't even been raised yet. Now, what do you say to that? What do you say to the resurrection of Christ? Yeah, lame people walking, blind people seeing, that's awesome. The dead people being raised to life. What do you do with that? Listen to me carefully. You have to do something with that man. You have to do something with that man. And many came out to see him, and many had questions. and many had doubts, and many didn't understand how this Son of God, that's blasphemous, but Son of David, this is good. And he kind of went, let's just sell all this stuff. Many came out to see him, and many believed. Just come on out to the Jordan. Just come on out. Don't sit there in your doubts. Don't sit there in all your questions. And don't sit there in all these things that you think you're justified in thinking. You need to have somebody question you. You need to have somebody who can kind of confront your doubts and your misgivings. So come across the Jordan. Because you have to do something with this man. You have to. You see, Jesus was the Son of God. And therefore, he was the perfect atoning sacrifice for your sin. And he bled and he died in your place so that you could have eternal life. And he will come back a second time. And he will come back not to save you, not to pay for your sins, not to give you a second chance. He's coming back to rule and to reign. And to pour out his wrath on anyone who would not submit to his authority. That's the way the scriptures say it. That is not my argument, that is the scriptures. He paid the price for your sin. What will you do with this man? Many came across the Jordan, and many believed, and they became his sheep. And they learned to hear his voice. And he knew them by name. And they follow him. Is that your story? Let's pray. Father, I thank you that Jesus didn't run away when they picked up the rocks. But that he showed your love. He engaged with these people who did not believe. He pled with them to believe. He pled with them because he loved them. He loved them with an infinite love. It was not based on any conditions or not based on any type of behavior.